Hello! Welcome to the first installment of Trimble Viewpoint's Construction Industry Basics Accounting Series. People don't start out in construction knowing everything about construction accounting, even if they are good with numbers or have a background related to general accounting. To become successful, they need to learn about construction-specific project accounting and how to apply best practices in a construction business. If you are new to construction, or if you just need a refresher on construction accounting, this series is for you. Let's start by reviewing some basic financial statements, which you may already be familiar with, since they are something every company needs, whether you're in construction or not. Then, we'll compare that to job cost reporting, which project-based industries like construction need. The balance sheet is a financial document that shows a snapshot of the company's financial situation at a specific point in time. If you want to know what sort of assets or liabilities you have, look to the balance sheet, where everything you own is listed alongside what you owe or must pay for. If the owner wants to know the net worth of the company, the balance sheet is the place to go because it calculates what is left over from the owner paying out what is owed. This is called equity, and it represents the initial money you put into the business and any profits earned. The balance sheet is called a balance sheet because it follows the equation assets are equal to liabilities plus equity. This means that the total value of all the company's assets should equal the total of its liabilities plus the equity. It helps you understand the financial health of the business and how much you own and owe. If you want to know whether you've made money, you'll want to look at an income statement. The income statement shows how much money a company has earned and spent over a specific period, usually a year, a month, or a quarter. It's like a report card for the company's financial performance. Think of it as a record of all the money that came in and went out during a certain time period. On it, you list all the revenue, which is the money earned through projects, work, and services, or even material sales or other income sources. You subtract all the expenses from the revenue. Expenses are the costs incurred to run the business, like wages, rent, utilities, supplies, and taxes. Subtracting these expenses from the revenue gives you the company's net income or profit. If the revenue is higher than the expenses, there is a positive net income, or the business has made a profit in that period. But if the expenses are higher than the revenue, there is a negative net income, which means the company has had a loss in the period. The income statement helps you understand how well the company is doing financially and whether it's making or losing money. If you want to see how you've done at the transactional level, you could run some general ledger transaction reports to let you see all the transactions that have been entered for that period. That would be every single one of your debits and credits for the whole month, quarter, or year, which will give you a deeper insight into whether the company has made money or not, with visibility at the transactional level across the business. You would be able to tell the owner or managing executive, for example, "Our expenses are greater than our income this month, so I'm confirming that we definitely did not make money." But what the owner is likely to want to know then are things like how much payroll the company had on the city library project, or how much cost you had in excavation on that project. They may want to know how productive a project work crew was. These are great questions that a construction owner or executive should be asking, because it allows them to evaluate the financial performance of the project, and the answers will drive more accurate future budgets and potentially better allocated resources. It helps them identify areas of improvement and also assess performances for training or incentives. Perhaps most importantly, the answers to these questions can inform decision-making now and on future projects. But the thing is, these are not questions that could be answered with an income statement alone, and you also have to go beyond the general ledger. Construction businesses need what is called a job cost ledger. This job cost ledger provides a detailed record that tracks and organizes all the costs associated and charged against a specific construction project. So, you may still be wondering, how does a job cost ledger differ from a general ledger? Let's dig into that. First, the general ledger is something that accountants really care about. Anytime an accounting transaction is recorded in the system, it hits the general ledger. This could be a payroll check, or an accounts payable invoice, or a credit card receipt. All accounting transactions hit general ledger. It is where all financial transactions of a business are recorded. A job cost ledger is used to track the costs associated to a specific project. This cost will also hit the general ledger, but the job cost ledger is what project managers care about. They want to know details on what the project costs are. You'll never meet a project manager who will ask you for details on the general ledger. When accountants talk about the general ledger, they talk about debits and credits and use language that can frustrate non-accounting people, like project managers. But project managers don't care about debits and credits. They care about dollar amounts. When an accountant posts to a general ledger, they are posting to a chart of accounts. Think of it as saying, hey, I'm posting this invoice to office supplies and posting this check payment to rent and posting this invoice against accounts receivable. But guess what? Project managers don't really care about the chart of accounts either. They care about things like cost types and cost codes. Now, when an accountant looks at a general ledger, they're going to look at the numbers and compare those against a budget, just like a project manager compares numbers to a budget. But a general ledger budget looks at company-wide spending, things like how much the company has spent on rent and how much the company has spent on materials so far in the year. The accountant is not paying attention to particular costs on a specific project at this point, but is paying attention to spending across the business. For project-specific costs, you'd want to look at the job cost ledger. When project managers want to compare a project's performance against its budget, this is where they go because they don't care about company-wide spending, but care very specifically about the project spending. Now that you know some accounting and job cost basics, let's take a closer look at the three basic elements of job costing. When a construction accounting team posts an accounting transaction, their system is going to ask for three pieces of information. What project did we spend this money on? What type of cost is it? For example, is it labor? Is it equipment? Is it materials? And third, the system is going to ask, how was the money spent? Was it on a CSI division? Was it on a specific kind of activity? Was it for the phase of a project? There are five standard cost types in the construction industry. Almost every company will use these five cost types: labor, equipment, material, production, and subcontractors. Now, depending on what type of company you're working with, you'll see that they may have additional types of cost types. For example, when I talk with a home builder, I might talk about an allowance. Talking to a civil contractor, you'll find that equipment is often not a detailed enough cost type. They'll break that down further into two categories: owned equipment and rented equipment. There are going to be variations on cost types, but these five cost types you see here are standard for all construction companies. So far, we have talked about tracking costs to a specific project, and we talked about the five general cost types. Now, let's get into the details on how the money is spent. Was it spent on electrical? Was it site work? How about concrete? These are all examples of CSI division codes. Let's talk about a real-world example at the Home Depot. Let's say you spent $500 at the Home Depot. Now, let's break that down. 100 of this was for concrete. Another 100 of this was for electrical. And that remaining $300 should be coded to masonry. See? Those are the division codes. Activity codes provide a more detailed breakdown of the work being performed within each division, and they represent tasks or activities within a division. So yes, it's good to know that it was electrical, but that's not enough detail for me. Was it rough and electrical? Was it finished electrical? Or are you installing electrical features? Those sorts of details are examples of activity codes. Phases or phase codes can be pretty tricky. Generally, they're a set of alphanumeric codes used to identify different stages or phases of a construction project. But here's the thing, these codes can mean different things to different people involved in the construction process. Some people refer to phases as a project phase. For example, some may consider completing a single building a phase of a larger residential project. Or maybe for a project manager, the phase code might represent a specific milestone like foundation work or framing. They use these codes to keep track of progress and make sure everything is on schedule. For subcontractors and tradespeople, phase codes might have a whole different meaning. They see these phase codes as a roadmap, guiding them to their specific tasks. So when they see something like MEP, they know it's time to get those wires, pipes, and systems in place. The client or project owner might have their own interpretation of phase codes. To them, it could be more about the overall progress and financials. They want to know if they're in the preparation or design phase, or finally moving on to construction where their vision becomes a reality. Phase codes can be a bit like a jigsaw puzzle, with each piece having a different significance to different folks. It's all about effective communication and understanding within the project across teams. So, in summary, while you may see these cost types as project expenses on an income statement that is run at the end of an accounting period, the job cost report focuses on specific jobs and provides a deeper level of detail. Also, instead of being only run at the end of a financial period like an income statement, the job cost report is generated through a project's duration to provide visibility and proactive control over the project's costs and progress. In this example of a pretty detailed job cost report, you can see all three elements of job costing at work. There's the project, there's the cost cone, and there's the cost type. So when a construction owner says, "I want to know how much money we spent on slab on grade during the month of March on the Paradise Road project," you can run these job cost reports that are pulling transactions from the job cost ledger to get the amount of detail that all project managers need to make good decisions on their projects. Job costing, along with other accounting workflows, can be difficult to manage in a way that maximizes your organization's efficiencies. Trimble Construction One is a connected suite which connects your office to the field to streamline these workflows with the industry's leading solutions to give you the right data for your projects. Check out what Trimble Construction One can do for you.